Okay, good evening everyone. So in the last class we discussed about the versioning feature on S3, right? So today we will discuss about another feature on the S3, which is encryption. So what is the meaning, what is the encryption, what exactly it will do, what is the meaning of encryption, or what that encryption will do? Have you ever heard about like encryption, or have you used this encryption service? I think every day whenever you browse any website, almost all websites are using this encryption. What exactly that encryption will do in your websites, or what kind of encryption it is? Okay, let us take a simple example. I think everybody will use gmail.com, right? So first, nobody will have any email account. So then they will create one Gmail account, right? So whenever they create, they will get one email address and password like this. This is the email address and there will be a password. Anyone who knows these credentials, they can log into that particular Gmail account, right? Okay, so where exactly these emails will be stored, like these credentials will be stored? Okay, keeping that aside, where is the Gmail server available? Somewhere across the globe, they will maintain the Gmail server and they will have some kind of a database in which they will maintain every username and password, right? And a user will use their own laptop or any machine and they will type gmail.com and they will click on sign in and then they will enter the email ID and password. Now, how that the user provides the correct username and password? Before opening the inbox, it will authorize or it will validate the entered credentials are correct or wrong, right? Where it will be validated? In your laptop or somewhere? Definitely not in your laptop, right? Because by using this laptop, any user can log into the Gmail using their own credentials. Like millions and millions of users can use this laptop to log in. If the verification is happening in this laptop, my laptop should contain all the usernames and passwords for the verification purpose, right? Definitely Gmail or Google will never maintain the copy of the username and passwords in every computer across the globe. What will happen whenever the user enters the username and password and once click on sign in or login, the request will be sent to the Google server. That means your username and password will be sent to the Google server where they will validate with the copy of the credentials stored in the database. So if the user enters the correct username and password, he will be able to open the mailbox. So in this particular place, everything is going to happen, the validation or authorization. Now, how the details will be forwarded? Generally, whatever the data you send, that will be sent in a plain text format. I think, do you guys know like phone tapping? Like whenever we use the land phones, if you take some kind of a landline phone and if you connect the landline to any cable, you can hear anything, right? In the same way, there is a concept called man in the middle attack. Man in the middle attack. What it is, there will be some user somewhere across the globe. What it will do is they will try to capture all the data transferring in the internet. So the data will be transmitted in terms of packets. Let us say I'm sending like 100 lines of data and all the 100 lines will be divided into 100 packets or so. And every packet will be transmitted from here to there. This is a kind of a source and this will be the kind of a destination. If the data packets are transferring in plain text format, if some user is trying to capture the data, they can capture all the data packets or some of the data packets and they can see whatever the data you are transferring from here to there. So they might see your username or they might see your password or they might see both of the things if they successfully capture all the data packets where there is no security, right? Okay, let us say here in the destination side, you are at the destination side and I am at the source side. I would like to send you one number. Let us say the number is a 10. I would like to send you one number called 10, which is a kind of a password to open something. So what I do over the internet, I will send you one number called 10. What will happen? The 10 will be transmitted in the plain text format. So if this user tries to capture that data packet, he is able to see that I am sending the value called 10. That means whatever I am sending, somebody can see what I am trying to send. What if I add, this is the actual value, right? Which I would like to send. What I do is I will add some number called 5 and I will send you 15. But this is not actual number to open the locker or something, right? But only you and me know what to do to get the actual value. Because already we had discussion that whenever I send you some number, I will add 5 and then only I will send you. Once you receive the number 15, what you will do is you will subtract the 5 and you will get the actual password or actual code to open the locker. But what this user can do? This user is able to see 15, but it will not work to open any of the lockers, right? So encryption is kind of like converting the data from one format to other format. But for understanding purpose, I took the example of some simple two numbers, like adding some 5. This adding some number is called as some kind of algorithm. If I send some adding some random numbers and if I send you, you don't know like what number you have to subtract to get the actual value, right? So we have to follow some algorithm. In this example, algorithm is like plus 5 is the algorithm. Whatever the data I send you, before sending, I will add plus 5 and I will send it to you. And you know the algorithm. So whenever you receive, you will do minus 5 so that you will get the actual data. By default, whenever you see any website which is running on HTTP, that is not a secure website. Whatever the data you enter into the web page, the data will be transmitted in plain text format. In plain text format, like human readable format. And nowadays, you can go for any website. Every website is using HTTPS, which is a secure. That means whenever you are sending the data will be encrypted and then only that will be sent out of your browser. Once the data is received by the destination or the server, the data will be decrypted and it will be converted into the human readable format. And this kind of encryption is called as in-transit encryption. The data will be only encrypted while it is in transit. What is the meaning of in transit? While it is traveling. So the encryption is basically, encryption is the process or a mechanism which you can convert the data from one format to other format using an encryption key. That encryption key contains the algorithm of your encryption mechanism. And there are different types of encryption mechanisms available. And in the Amazon, they are using AES 256 algorithm, which is the most complex algorithm, which is most commonly used algorithm mechanism. AES 256, Advanced Encryption System 256-bit. So first, let us write down about what exactly the encryption is. Encryption is the method by using which we can convert the data from one format to another format using an encryption key. Encryption key is like a kind of a key of your locker. If you lose the encryption key, you cannot recover your data. You cannot decrypt the data. So in this encryption, we have two different types of encryption methods available or encryption types available. One already we discussed with an example, which is in-transit encryption. The first one is in transit encryption, and the second one is data at rest encryption. One is a in transit encryption, and the second one is a data at rest encryption. First, let us discuss about in transit encryption, for which we are not responsible. For in transit encryption, we are not responsible. Why? We will discuss in some time. This in transit encryption is used to encrypt the data while it is in transmission. While it is in transmission only. The best example is for websites. All the websites with HTTPS are using in transit encryption. How this in transit encryption will work? Because I said, like, whenever you enter the data and click on submit or something, the data will leave your browser, and before leaving, the data will be encrypted and then it will be transmitted. Once it is received by the destination, again it will be decrypted. How the source and destination are able to communicate with the algorithm? What exactly the algorithm is defined? So first thing, HTTPS website. How the HTTPS websites are configured? Do you guys know, like, how to maintain a HTTPS website? Or at least can you differentiate how a normal website looks like and a secure website looks like? I might not be able to show you an example of a normal website because it is very hard to find out a normal website. To know, like, how the normal website looks like, the one which we hosted in the first EC2 classes, we hosted one web page, right? Welcome to something we have. That is called as a normal website. Whatever the data you enter there, that is not transmitted in an encryption. The plain data will be transmitted. The data will be transmitted in plain text format. Let us say if you are using some kind of a sign in register, something is there, so that the user has to mention there all the details, right? Those details will be transmitted in plain text format. How a secure website looks like is, this is the way how it looks like. If you see here, I think I cannot zoom it. You can see some lock symbol here, right? That is what the HTTPS website is. So HTTPS websites will be configured using a certificate called SSL certificate. What is that SSL stands for? Any idea? What is the full form of SSL? Any guess? Secure Socket Layer. SSL stands for Secure Socket Layer. So can I get one SSL certificate to host my website? Okay, let me show you the example of that SSL certificate. If you click on this lock symbol, you can see one message like connection is secure. If you click on that, there is one message called certificate is valid, right? Let me click on that. So you can see that this certificate is issued to this particular domain name. There is something called something.amazon.com. That means that certificate is only valid for that amazon.com. By using that certificate, I cannot configure my website called abc.com or xyz.com. By seeing this lock symbol, we can trust that that is the correct domain name or the correct website. If you would like to host any website using the SSL, we have to generate one certificate. And to get the certificate, you must be the owner of the website name. I cannot generate or I cannot create a certificate for google.com because I am not the owner of the google.com website. So to generate the website, first we need to be owner of that particular website name. It's like not a trademark because they will validate that whether you are the owner or not. Because trademark is permanent, right? The domain names is based on like tenure. We are not purchasing the websites, just we are registering. You can register the website from 1 year to 10 years. After expiring or before expiry, you can renew it. You cannot buy any domain name permanently. Even the google.com also, they will renew for every 10 years or every 5 years, depends on their requirement. Any website can be registered from 1 year to 10 years maximum. After that, they can renew it. Like, let us say if I am able to generate an SSL certificate for google.com, but I am not the owner, right? So what I can do by using that certificate, I can pretend that I am sending an email from google.com, or I can pretend to be like I am maintaining a google.com website. That's why to generate the SSL certificate, you must be the owner of that particular website. Okay, right. So here we can clarify that we are not responsible for in-transit data encryption. So yesterday we uploaded some data into the S3 bucket, right? From my laptop, I am sending the data to the S3 bucket. So who will take care of encryption of that particular data? Amazon itself, because we are using Amazon.com website. Whoever is the owner of this website, whenever they are maintaining the website, they will configure the SSL to secure whatever the data you are using on this website. So we can ignore that in-transit part, as we are not responsible and we cannot configure the in-transit encryption. Okay, so then the important thing is data at rest encryption. This is our responsibility to configure the data at rest encryption. Do you guys know like what is a data at rest encryption? Any guess? Okay, let us take the same example. Like we uploaded some files into the S3 bucket. While the data object is leaving from my laptop, Amazon will take care of the encryption. Once it is uploaded to the S3 bucket, then the object will be decrypted and it will be stored in a plain format, like a plain object. So whoever has the permission, they can view it. Everything is good. What is that? Then what about the security of the data, whatever you are storing on the S3 bucket? Generally, Amazon will take care of security of the cloud. But why we need, or what is the data at rest encryption and why we need it? Data at rest encryption means it is showing that at rest encryption, right? Once the data got stored on any hard disk, that data has to be secured using the encryption. That is called as a data at rest encryption. On my laptop, I have a lot of data on every laptops, right? Is it secure? How it is secure? Let us say, I will take the example. So you have a laptop or a desktop, whatever it is, that doesn't matter. Let us take the example of desktop. So here you have stored very important and confidential data. So that has some kind of a hard disk, right? All the data will be stored on this hard disk. You are using some Windows operating system. So to log into that Windows operating system, you have to provide username and password. That means you have set a password which is a more complex. Nobody can crack the password. Do you think that whatever the password you stored on this hard disk is secure or a safe? If yes, why? Again, if no, how? How it is not secure way to store? Because if someone got like stolen your entire hard laptop or desktop, do they able to see all your data? No. Why? He cannot log in. Okay. Let us say I stolen the laptop or desktop, whatever it is. So I will try to log in. So I cannot log in because I don't know the username and password. You guys think that the data is secure. What if I will remove the hard disk? I will remove the hard disk and I have another computer. Here already I have a C drive, which is having some Windows operating system only. And I will connect this as additional drive. I will connect this hard disk as an additional drive. So whenever I start my desktop or laptop, my computer will start with my C drive operating system only, right? So I can log into my laptop and I can see your hard disk as a D drive. So I can read all the data, right? So then where is the security? There is no security, right? But generally, these kind of things will not happen in the cloud, but in the worst situation, so we are storing all the data into the S3 bucket, right? But whatever the data you store into the S3 bucket, in the back end, they will be stored onto some hard drives, right? Physical hard disk. What if that physical hard disk in which your data got stored is in some unauthorized person's hand? Then, like, someone got stolen the same hard disk on which you stored your data. Then what will happen? They can see all your data, right? Which is not possible. But in the worst case, your data is not maintaining securely. Okay. To go to this particular S3, now let us say I have used some kind of encryption on my laptop. Do you guys know Windows has an inbuilt encryption tool? But I think that is not available on home basic. But if you go for professional or enterprise level operating system, you will get a tool. Have you ever heard about like BitLocker? BitLocker. BitLocker is an encryption tool. What it will do is, if you enable that, your entire drive will be encrypted and it will have an encryption key, right? That will be integrated with your hardware, like motherboard, CPU, RAM. These will be integrated with the BitLocker. What it will do, all the data will be encrypted. As far as that hard disk is connected to that laptop, the data is visible. If I remove the hard disk from my laptop and if I connect to your laptop, it will not allow you to open hard disk because your computer don't know what is the encryption key to decrypt the data, because the encryption key is used to encrypt and decrypt the data. So that's how every company will maintain their data in a secure way. So this BitLocker is a regular one, but they will use some separate tools also. Symantec is providing their own service for encryption, which is the licensed versions. Every company, whoever is working as a storage administrators, they will aware of these kind of encryptions. They will install the encryption software and they will configure the encryptions and they will generate the encryption key for each and every use case and they will manage that. In the same way, to secure our data, which is getting stored on S3 bucket, Amazon is providing you an encryption mechanism, which is data at rest encryption. By using the data at rest encryption, we can secure the data by encrypting after storing into the S3 bucket. So data at rest encryption is a type of encryption which will encrypt the data once it got stored into the storage. So whatever the encryption we use on S3, that is called as a data at rest encryption. And while uploading, there is an in-transit encryption which will be taken care by the AWS itself. And as an employee or as an account owner, we are responsible for the data at rest encryption on S3 buckets. So here we have to use a key called encryption key, and that encryption key is used to encrypt and decrypt the data. For both encryption and decryption, the same key will be used to encrypt and decrypt the data. We have to use an encryption key. So AWS will use AES 256 algorithm for the encryption keys. to generate the encryption key, they have to use the algorithm, right? Amazon uses AES 256. What is AES stands for? Not Amazon Elastic. AES is not a AWS related term. That's a general term available in the entire IT industry. What is AES and what is a 256 then? Any guess what might be the 256? Not version, that's a 256 bit. We show you. For everything, there is something called, so here AES 256, right? It is a 256 encryption mechanism. 256 is the number of bits. The key will have 256 bit length. What is a bit? What is a bit? Let us say here, I can say supports is there, a THE DA is there. Can I say, is it a 3-bit? Can I say that as a 3-bit? No. Bit is 0 or 1. 0 or 1 is called as a bit. 2 is not a single bit. 2 will be represented as a 1-0, right? That is a 2-bit. That's a 2-bit. So 256 indicates 256 bits length of the encryption key. The encryption key contains total 256 bits. Then what is AES? What is AES? Any guess? Any random guess? AES stands for Advanced Encryption System with 256 bit key length. The encryption key will have the length of 256 bit. That means total it will contains 256 ones and zeros. Again, to enable or to encrypt the data at rest, we have to create the encryption, right? Sorry, we have to create the encryption key or we have to use the encryption key. So you have to select which encryption key to use for the encryption. The process of encryption, decryption, everything will be taken care of by the Amazon itself. Only we are going to take care of the encryption keys. So here, totally there are on Amazon, we have a two types of encryption keys available. We have a two types of encryption keys available. Like I can say types of encryption keys. Or before that, wait a second. Before that, before discussing about the types of encryption keys, we have to discuss about types of data at rest encryption also. But on Amazon, we will use only one type, but it will be good to know about the two different types of data at rest encryptions. Types of data at rest encryption. Any guess what might be those two? Server side encryption and the second one is a client side encryption. Any guess what might be the server side or client side with respect to S3? What might be the meaning of server side encryption and what is the meaning of a client side encryption? Okay, just let us discuss about these two with respect to the S3. Server side encryption means the data will be encrypted once it's been uploaded to the S3 bucket. So the encryption process, decryption process will be taken care by the server. In our case, the server is the S3. Client side encryption means before uploading the data or before storing the data, you have to encrypt and then you have to upload it. Server is not responsible for encryption or decryption. So there are a number of tools available. So in my laptop, I will install one such kind of a tool and I will create one encryption key. Let us say I would like to upload one PDF file. So before uploading, I will encrypt the PDF document and then I will upload into the S3 bucket. So nobody can see that, because nobody knows about the encryption key, right? Only I can see, or with whom I will share the encryption key, they can view what is the data contains in the PDF document. Anybody can download, but they cannot open it. So to view that kind of objects, you have to download it first. And then by using the same encryption key, you have to decrypt using some third-party tools. That is what the client-side encryption, which is not taken care by the Amazon. That is completely using the third-party tools. Client-side encryption is like uploading the object. Uploading the object into S3 by encrypting on client side. I can say in our laptop. So Amazon is nowhere responsible for that. But server side encryption means server will take care of all the entire encryption and decryption. Just you are responsible for choosing the encryption key. Server side encryption. So encryption and decryption will be taken care by the server at server side using the encryption key which we selected or created. In our example, the server is S3. In our example, the server is S3. So here on Amazon S3, there are two different types of encryption keys available. There are two different types of encryption keys available. Types of encryption keys. One is SSE-S3. What is SSE? What is SSE here? Server-side encryption. SSE stands for server-side encryption. And then we have SSE-KMS. KMS. We will discuss about those things in detail. And in this KMS, we have SSE, or I can say AWS managed KMS key. And the second one is customer managed KMS key. This is not client side encryption. And then the third one is SSE-C. C means client side, which is not taken care by the Amazon. So before uploading the data, you have to encrypt and then you have to upload. So now let us discuss about each and every encryption key, and we will see how to enable such kind of encryption on your S3 buckets, so that automatically whatever the data you upload, those data will be encrypted using that encryption keys or encryption type. The first one is SSE-S3. So completely the encryption is based on the encryption key only, right? So in SSE-S3, the encryption key will be created by AWS S3 and managed by S3 itself. So you are not responsible even for creating the encryption key. That is called as a every service, there will be a default encryption key. If you enable encryption using SSE-S3, then the object will be encrypted using the default encryption key which will be created and managed by S3. Does Amazon will maintain that encryption key in a safe and secure place? Yes, because whatever the encryption key we use for the SSE-S3, again, the key will be encrypted using a master key. Let us say there are 100 customers on Amazon. So every customer is using SSE-S3 encryption mechanism. So every account will have their own key, right? What they do is all these 100 keys will be encrypted again using a master encryption key, which will have access to Amazon only. So to use that key, first Amazon has to decrypt the key. Then the key will be used to decrypt your data. Like a kind of like we have a locker, small locker. You can keep your money and valuables into that locker and you can lock it. And again, keeping that locker in a big locker, like a kind of two type of a locking system. So here, no need to worry about how the encryption key will be maintained in a safe and secure place. Amazon will take care of the SSE-S3 encryption key creation and maintenance. There's like default way of using the SSE-S3. In this case, you will not have control over the encryption key. We will not have the control over the encryption key because Amazon will maintain and Amazon will use that particular encryption key. So now what we do is, let us see how to enable that SSE-S3 type of encryption. So first, I will create S3 bucket. And let me use the name as encryption 1 July 2022. And I don't want to enable encryption at this point of time because by default, no bucket will be created with encryption enabled. All the buckets will be created using encryption disabled. Okay. So create an S3 bucket without encryption. Then enable encryption using SSE-S3. And then upload any object. So that will be automatically encrypted and try to access or download the object. Try to access or download, like try to open or download. Just to avoid the confusion, try to open or download the object. What will happen? Are we able to see the document? Yes, because I log in with authorized credentials, right? So automatically, whenever I click on open, Amazon will decrypt and then it will be visible. It will be displayed because Amazon is having the encryption key, right? All valid requests will be allowed. Invalid requests will not be allowed. Like invalid means like removing your hard disk from your laptop and connecting to my laptop. That is invalid way, right? Those kind of things are not allowed if you encrypt your data. Okay. So now let us do this. Then we can go with KMS. KMS is a different service available on Amazon platform. That KMS service is used to create your own encryption keys. You can create your own encryption key. Okay. And here, let me log into our Amazon account and then go to S3 service. Just we are creating the S3 bucket. We are trying to create the S3 bucket. Let me click on create bucket. So just let me use this name. And I don't want to make any object to be public, so I can go with all default options. If you would like to enable the encryption, here you can enable. It will show you two different options, right? SSE-S3 and SSE-KMS. But here I will disable only. Later we will enable. And here you can see there is some information here. to upload an object with a customer provided encryption key, which is SSC-C, use the CLI, AWS SDK, or some REST APIs. Okay. All right. So now that is a completely different, that is not client side encryption. There's a different type of encryption mechanism that we will see, which is not possible using the browser. Click on create bucket. Wait. I'm not sure like whether I created with encryption enabled or not. But anyways, if it got created with encryption, I will show you from where we can enable. So just click on the bucket and go to properties. And here, default encryption, generally that will be disabled, but I selected enable and I created it, right? So you have to click on edit and you have to select Amazon S3 managed keys, which is SSE-S3, which is SSE-S3. Click on save changes so that on your bucket, encryption with SSE-S3 is enabled. SSE-S3 is enabled. Okay, so now we will upload one object. How to upload any object? Just click on the bucket, select your click on upload and select your object. Any object you can. So let me select any object here. And let me click on upload. Is it going to be automatically encrypted? Yes or no? Yes. Okay. How to check whether the object got encrypted or not? How to check? If you click on the object, so there will be some information, right? If you scroll down, somewhere you can see the option for encryption settings. And it is enabled with this encryption and the object got encrypted using this one. Okay, so now what is the next step? We have to access the object, right? How to open the object? Select that, click on open. Once I click on open, because I am a valid user, automatically the object will be decrypted and I can view the object. This is what simple step to enable SSE-S3. Now we will see what is SSE-KMS. We will see what is SSE-KMS. So here the KMS stands for Key Management Service. So already we know what is SSE. Now we need to know what is a KMS, right? KMS is an AWS service by using which we can create our own keys, which we can create or manage our own encryption keys. So I can create one key here and I can share that key with your Amazon account. So you can use my key to encrypt the data on your Amazon account also. But normal SSE-S3 is not possible. So what is the requirement of sharing the key? Let us say I'm your client. So you are maintaining my servers. You are maintaining my servers in your Amazon account. So I would like to enable encryption, but that encryption to be done using my encryption key. I don't want to allow you to use your encryption keys. So what I do, I will create encryption key and I will share that encryption key with your Amazon account. So whatever the data or whatever my data is storing on your Amazon account storage can be encrypted using my encryption key. That is where we can use the sharing concept. Okay. So here, KMS is an AWS service by using which we can create or manage our own encryption keys. Again, in the KMS, we have two types of keys available. One is KMS, AWS managed KMS key. And the second one is customer managed KMS key. In the AWS managed key, AWS will create an encryption key using KMS service. Same as SSE-S3, but here AWS will create an encryption key for you using KMS service. Whereas the customer managed KMS key, customer means we are the customers of Amazon, right? So we have to create our own encryption key using KMS service. Like two things are like, one, by using KMS service, Amazon will create an encryption key for you. Or you can create encryption key using KMS service manually. Let us say like you have a car. So you can drive your own car or you can hire someone to drive your own car, right? The car is yours, but the thing is whether you are driving it or someone is driving for you. In the same way, there is a KMS service. Are you creating your own key or would you like to allow AWS to create your key? Those are the two different options. So what we do is, I will disable the encryption key, or we can create one more bucket, that doesn't matter. Or the question is, can I upload, or what we call that, can I change the encryption mechanism on an existing S3 bucket to a different encryption key? Yes. Or keeping the default sitting as is, can I upload another file using a different encryption key? Already we uploaded one object, right? What is the object name? Standard IA. Can I upload another file called Glacier into the same bucket using a different encryption key? Yes, you can. But that you have to select at the time of uploading the data. If you don't select any encryption type, it will take the default encryption which we enabled on the S3 bucket. But we have an option that you can select what type of encryption key to be used for individual objects also. So what I do is, instead of creating a new bucket, upload different object into the same bucket on which we enabled the SSE-S3 encryption mechanism using SSE-KMS AWS managed key. AWS managed key. So before enabling that, I would like to log into the KMS service and let us see how the KMS service looks like. Okay, but I don't want to create any key at this moment. In the next step, we will create one more key and we'll upload another object into the same bucket so that we can observe the KMS customer managed key also. Okay, so here let me type key management service, or you can type KMS also. So key management service, or even if you type KMS, you will get the same service at the top. Key management service, securely generate and manage AWS encryption keys. Okay, click on key management service and it will takes you to the dashboard of the KMS service. It will takes you to the dashboard of the key management service. On the left side, how many options you can see? AWS managed keys and customer managed keys. What is the third one? Custom key stores. What is that custom key stores means? What might be that custom key stores? Let me click on this. What is that? I got a message like, you don't have any custom key stores. Basically, Amazon will provide you a physical hardware for the key management service, like kind of a physical device to generate and to manage the encryption keys. If you purchase such kind of a thing, that you can get here. We call it as Cloud HSM, Hardware Security Module, HSM. hardware security module, which is used to generate the encryption keys only, but by using a hardware device. Okay. So now if I click on customer managed keys, I don't have any because we haven't created any encryption keys yet. What will happen if I click on AWS managed keys? There is no keys. Right now, there is no key available under AWS managed keys also. But when it will be created? Whenever you enable SSE-KMS using AWS managed key, then automatically it will create one encryption key in the KMS service for S3 service. For every service, they will generate a separate key using the KMS. Okay. So now let us upload a different object into the same S3 bucket using SSE KMS AWS managed key. So for that, just go to your S3 service, navigate to S3 service. Select the bucket name. If I upload any object by default, that will be encrypted using SSE-S3. But now I will click on upload, select add files. I will select a Glacier instant file. But before clicking on that, I will click on properties. Scroll down. Here you can see server side encryption setting. Select specify an encryption key. And here use default encryption bucket setting. That is the first option. And the second option is override default encryption bucket setting. Override default encryption bucket setting. That means this object will not be encrypted using the default encryption which you applied on the bucket. Then with which encryption it has to be applied. That you can select here. Select, okay, from the top. So if you click on the properties, sorry, what is that? Yeah, properties. And if you scroll down, you can find out a feature called server-side encryption settings. Now select specify an encryption key. Specify an encryption key. And then under encryption settings, select override default encryption bucket settings so that the default settings will not be applied to this object and that will be applied with a different one. Which one? I would like to select AWS key management service under encryption key type. Whenever you select SSE-KMS, it will ask you two different options. Actually, here you can see three. The first one is AWS managed key. If you would like to have a customer managed keys, you have to select this one. And the third one is, if you would like to use a KMS key from a different Amazon account, then you have to use the third option. Okay. So select AWS managed key, which is AWS-S3. Under AWS KMS key, select AWS managed key. And then just click on upload. Object will be uploaded without any issues. Now the object got encrypted using SSE-KMS with AWS managed key. With AWS managed key. How to identify that? If I click on the object and if I scroll down, and you can see it is with SSE-KMS. And you can see the encryption key ARN. But earlier, if you get into the KMS service, we don't have any keys, right? But now we got one key here automatically, which is created automatically by AWS. That's why we call it as AWS managed keys. Then what is the customer managed keys? What is the customer managed keys? Customer managed keys is the encryption key which has to be created by the customer. So now what we do is create an encryption key manually using the service KMS, which is called as customer managed key. which is called as customer managed key. There is a lot of difference between the customer managed key and customer provided key. Customer provided key will not comes under KMS. That is a completely different that I will discuss later. Customer managed key. And once we are done with that, then we will upload a different object into the same S3 bucket using SSE-KMS with customer managed key. So first we have to see how to create the encryption key. What that encryption key contains, any guess? What exactly that encryption key will contains? Again, there are two different types of encryption keys available, like symmetric and asymmetric. So in one category, it will create some kind of public and private keys, in which public key will be used to encrypt and private key will be used to decrypt. But nowadays, everyone is using a symmetric key, where a single key will be generated, which will be used for both encryption and decryption mechanisms. Okay, now let us see how to create an encryption key using the KMS service. First, navigate to the KMS service, type KMS, and open the key management service. And then on the left side, directly you can click on create a key here. On the left side, click on customer managed keys. If you observe in the AWS managed key, there is no option to create, right? Because that is only created and managed by AWS. Select customer managed keys. And here, click on create key. So here, there are two different types, symmetric and asymmetric, right? If you see the symmetric, a single key used for encrypting and decrypting the data or generating for any purpose. Encryption key can be used for multiple things, right? Single key will be used for all the things. Whereas asymmetric encryption key is a pair of public and private keys where public key will be used for encryption and private key will be used for the decryption. So here what I do is I will select the symmetric and key uses. What is our uses? Encryption and decryption. So you can select this encrypt and decrypt. Scroll down. Click on next. And what is this advanced option? There might be any useful information. Key material origin. Like where the key is getting created, KMS, not external or not custom keystore. And you can select the key to be available in a single region or multiple region also. By default, the key can be used in the same region. You cannot use that key in any different region. That is how we will use a best practice also. So if you click on advanced options, just read the options and keep it as a default. Don't change the values. Click on next. So here you can use some name. I can say AWS S3 encryption key. You can use any name, that doesn't matter. Just it requires some name. Created by KMS service. Created in KMS service by customer. Then you can add some tags also if required. Tag is for identification purpose. Then you can click on next. What is this? Define key administrative permissions. Go with the default options. Don't select any of these, not required. What is the meaning of this is, the key administrators, the administrator is able to delete this key. Whoever the user is having administrator permission, key administrator permission, they can delete this key. That is the meaning of this particular checkbox. If I uncheck this one, no administrator can delete that particular encryption key. So keep that a checkbox and click on next. Define key usage permissions. Who can use this key? Anybody or a specific person? So generally here, you can see the list of all users available in your Amazon account. I deleted all the IAM users, so that's why you cannot see anything here. Or you can select a role, or you can apply to a role so that anybody can use that. And here, if you would like to allow any other AWS accounts to use your KMS key, you can add that AWS account here. You have to get their account ID and you can add here so that your key will be used by other AWS accounts also. Okay, then click on next. So here you can review all the options, whatever you have selected. And then click on finish. Based on the options, automatically the policy will be created. Like with whom you would like to share that, with which AWS account or with which users, everything, whatever we have selected, based on that, the policy will be automatically generated. You can see here, only the root user will be allowed in this particular AWS account to use this particular key. No other user can use. By seeing this policy, enable IAM user permissions. Allow permission is there only for root user in this Amazon account. That is the meaning of this policy. Automatically, it got generated based on the options what we have selected. Click on finish and the KMS key will be generated. And you can see KMS key got generated, right? So now you can click on view key and just you can see the every information about the key. Okay, so what is the ARN? Amazon resource name, which is a unique identification of the resources on Amazon. So now what is the next step? We need to upload a different object into the same S3 bucket using customer managed key on KMS. So for that, just go to the S3 bucket, click on upload, add files. Let me select a file, properties. The same process we have to repeat, but the option is here you have to select, choose from your AWS KMS keys. Select, choose from your KMS keys under AWS KMS key option. Then from the drop down, you can see this is the name of the encryption key which I selected, right? AWS dash S3 dash encryption key. You cannot see the AWS managed key in this option. So select that key. Scroll down and click on upload. Now the object got uploaded, right? Now what we do is, try to open the object. Try to open the object which we just uploaded. Is it possible or not? Yes, it is, because the key is available with Amazon. So whenever you try to open it, object will be opened. So at that time, the object will be decrypted and the data will be visible. So the key which I created in the KMS, that is created by myself, right? So if I disable the key, what will happen? If I disable the key, what will happen? Still the file is encrypted, right? If I disable the key, what will happen? Now, disable the customer managed KMS key and try to access the object which is encrypted using that encryption key. What is your guess? What will happen? Whenever you click on open, S3 service will call that encryption key, and using that encryption key, the object will be decrypted and it will be visible to you. Now I am disabling the encryption key. So you can think like you deleted the encryption key. So there is no encryption key to perform the decrypt process, right? What will happen? What will happen? A random guess. You lost your key. Will you be able to open the door? No. In the same way, if you disable that encryption key or if you delete the encryption key, you cannot open the objects. Let us do that. First, how to disable? How to disable? Go to your KMS service. You cannot disable AWS managed keys. You cannot manage the AWS managed keys. Only you can manage the customer managed keys. So click on customer managed keys. And select the key. Can I delete this? No, you cannot delete. So for, you have to schedule for deletion. I will show you that also. Click on key action. Are you able to get the delete key material feature? Directly, you cannot delete. Because the problem is, by mistakenly, if I delete any key, if any object is encrypted using that key, it cannot be decrypted, right? Just to be on safer side, they don't allow you to delete the key instantly. You have to schedule a key deletion, like from 7 days to 35 days. After the completion of those many days, only you can delete that. So in the meanwhile, if any object is using that encryption key, you will get the error message so that you can realize and you can re-enable that. Okay, right. So here I'm clicking on disable. Clicking on disable. Select the checkbox like confirm that you want to disable the key. And click on disable key. So key got disabled. Now what will happen if I try to access that object? KMS disabled exception. So Amazon tried to use that encryption key to decrypt the object to display, but it is unable to use the key because the key is disabled. So if you lose the encryption key, you cannot get your data back. Okay, right. So now what will happen if I re-enable this? It seems it got enabled, right? So select the object, click on open. So as far as you have the encryption key, you can get the data. If you lose the encryption key, you cannot get your data back. So how to delete the object? Sorry, how to delete the key? How to delete the encryption key? So let us see how to delete. So we cannot delete encryption key instantly. Instead, we have to schedule the key deletion after certain number of days. Example 7 or example, seven. So on 8th day, you can delete. During these 7 days, the key will be disabled, like a kind of disable mode. So if there is something is going wrong, you can identify it easily and you can cancel that scheduled deletion. Okay. So now what we do is schedule key deletion for KMS key after 7 days and try to open the object again. So you will get the same error, like same kind of error. Even if the key got scheduled, the object cannot be decrypted. Like then what we do is on 8th day after 7 days, delete the encryption key from KMS. And one more thing. are these KMS keys free or chargeable? They are chargeable. You will be charged per key, whether you use it for one day or one month. They will charge you for a whole month. I'm not sure the pricing. It might be $1 or $2 per key. I'm not sure is it $1 or $2, but the cost is, let us say $1, $1 per key. If you use it for only one day also, you will be charged $1. You will be used for like 5 minutes also, you will be charged $1. That's for sure. Okay. But for SSC-S3, there is no charges. And AWS managed keys also, there is no charges. But the customer managed keys, for every key, there will be a separate charge. If you create 3 times in a single month, like let us say, today I created, right? After 8 days, I will delete this. On 10th day, if I create one more key, they will consider that as a second key, and for that, you will be charged. Okay? All right. So now let us see how to schedule that key deletion. Go to your KMS service, click on customer managed key, select the key, click on key actions and select schedule key deletion. And waiting period. And you can see deleting a key makes all data encrypted under that key unrecoverable. You cannot recover that. So here, you can cancel deletion at any time before the waiting period ends. You can cancel at any time before the waiting period. Waiting period is like 7 to 30 days. I will select the 7 days. So we can come back on 8th day and we will delete that key. And click on skip. Okay. Here, check the confirmation. Check the box like confirmation. That you are giving the confirmation that you want to delete or you are scheduling the keys for deletion after 7 days waiting period. Click on schedule deletion. So during these 7 days, this key cannot be deleted. What is the status? Pending deletion. During this pending deletion time, are we able to access the objects which got encrypted? Invalid state exception. The key, encryption key, is invalid state, which cannot be used for the decryption process. So you have to know about like SSC-S3, SSC-KMS. In the KMS, we have two different types, right? And we have one more type, which is SSC-C. Generally, we don't use that, but we have to know what is that SSC-C. First, what is SSC? Server-side encryption. So here it is SSE, customer-provided key. Customer-provided key. What is the meaning of that is, I don't want to use the encryption key generated by S3 by default. And I don't want to use the default key generated in the KMS. And I don't want to generate the key using the KMS. Because my organization has their own encryption tool, like key generation tool. I would like to generate my own encryption key using some third party tool. But now, how Amazon will identify that key, or the Amazon has to use that encryption key to encrypt your data? Customer provided key. And the key is not related to any AWS service, but still the encryption will be done on Amazon site. We will generate the key on your own tools. So here, encryption key will be generated and provided by the customer, or I can say, encryption key will be generated by the customer using their own tools. It can be anything, some ABC, XYZ tools. Then how Amazon will encrypt the data? While uploading the object customer has to include the encryption key along with the object. Because in the Amazon doesn't store that encryption key. Just you have to attach the key while you are uploading, so that Amazon will do the encryption on server side itself. And AWS will take care of the encryption on server side. But the thing is, SSE-C cannot be used, or we can say cannot be used for uploading the objects using the browser. You cannot use SSE-C type for your object encryption while uploading the object using the browser, because along with the object you have to provide the encryption key also. So SSE-C can be used with CLI, AWS CLI, or AWS SDK, and AWS REST APIs. And there will be some APIs which might support adding the encryption key while you are uploading. You cannot use the browser. Just you need the theoretical knowledge. What is SSE-C? Client-side encryption is completely different. Amazon will not do any kind of encryption or decryption. But here, encryption is customer responsibility. Sorry, encryption key is customer responsibility. And the process of encryption and decryption is the Amazon's responsibility in SSE-C. Okay. So client-side encryption means, already we discussed, right? Before uploading the data, you have to encrypt on your laptop or desktop, and then you have to upload it. Amazon won't do anything about encryption or decryption. It will blindly store your data. Even if someone got stolen the hard disk, they can get the object, but they cannot view what is the data, because the key is in your laptop or in your server. They cannot see what is the content available in that particular object. But ultimate thing of the encryption is converting the data or converting the object from one format to other format, so that nobody can view your objects unless they have access to your encryption key. In-transit encryption, we are not responsible. We don't have an option also. We don't have authorization. Only we have to do the data at rest encryption. And for the data at rest encryption, we have different types of keys, SSE-S3 and SSE-KMS. In the KMS, Amazon managed key and customer managed key. Sometimes you guys might confuse with customer managed and customer provided keys. Okay, you have to get the differentiation between the customer managed and customer provided keys. Okay, right. So this is about the encryption. And are you guys clear, or any questions on this encryption? Okay. And one more thing, tomorrow we don't have a session. Like, I have some work. So the next session will be on Monday. Okay. So I will upload this document also. So just complete the practicals, whatever we have covered as of now. And if you have any questions while you're doing the practicals, you can ask me. Any question? Disable. Okay. Upload object into same S3 bucket using KMS. Okay. How to upload, right? Okay. Or if you are getting confused, create three different buckets for all the encryption types. But what I am showing is you can upload multiple objects into the same bucket using different types of encryption methods. Okay, so here, by default, if you upload any object with default options, that will be enabled, that will be encrypted using SSE-S3, because that is what I enabled on the bucket. So if you upload using a different encryption key, select the object, any object, So would you like to enable with KMS, AWS managed care, whatever it is, that doesn't matter. Instead of clicking on upload, click on properties, scroll down to find out server side encryption settings. Then here, specify an encryption key. Then select override default encryption bucket settings. Then you can select what type of encryption key you would like to use. Select here, go to bottom and click on upload. Okay, right. So any other questions on this? Okay, so if you guys are clear, let us stop the session and let us continue on Monday. Okay, so okay, out of all these, which keys are chargeable? Custom. Which one? The keys which you created manually in the KMS service. If you go to the KMS service, we have two types. One is AWS managed key and the second one is customer managed key. AWS managed keys are not chargeable, but the customer managed keys, if you create a key, you will be charged. I created one key manually, right? That is chargeable. $1 or $2, I'm not sure. The price is like fixed price. I guess $1 it is. Okay, any other questions? Okay, then thank you everyone. Let us continue on Monday.
మీకు నోటిఫికేషన్ రాదు, ఓన్లీ ఫస్ట్ ఒకసారి
Okay, if anybody having any questions, you can raise your hand so that you guys can unmute and just you can ask the questions. Okay, it seems everyone is clear, no questions. Okay then, thank you everyone. We'll continue from Monday.